Del curso tenemos a,
to close this part
a
of
Fernanda
our
Perea
seminar,
Manso.
We have Fernanda
Fernanda
Perea Manso. She is a nutrition lawyer by the Latinoamericana University,
campus
health sciences in the Morelos State, with a diploma in clinical nutrition and clinical management and nutrition by the Tec de Monterrey University. And she is a clinical nutriologist in the Centro de Obesidad de Nutrición from the ABC Center or ABC, working with Dr. Herrera. And she is a professor in the Diplomate of Universidad La Salle in the Nutritional Treatment of Obese Patients and has participated in some papers and presentations of verbal or oral works. I'm very happy to have you here, Fernanda. Thanks a lot. Well, this talk is about the prevention of nutritional deficiencies in the pre- and post-operative stages. We are going to talk about nutritional assessments, pre-op preparation, perioperative management, and supervision in the long term. Within the nutritional assessment that we have to perform a patient when he presents to us, we have, of course, the nutritional clinical history, anthropometric data, biochemical data. We have to find out the motivation of the patient to have the surgery, the level of physical activity, the previous attempts to lose weight, and also caloric consumption and energetic needs. Well, we have already heard about the types of surgery. We know that we have restrictive, some of them with restriction and malabsorption. And the intention of a patient to submit to bariatric surgery is always going to be to lose weight. Here we can see that all the surgeries have an impact, a positive impact in weight loss, but we can see that all the surgeries lead to increasing weight as of the second year, usually after the second year. As nutriologists, there we have to act to promote a healthy weight loss and also to help them maintain this weight loss in the long term. Different absorption sites, also in the intestines, and this is also very important to know, to assess which are going to be the main deficiency causes after bariatric surgery. These causes are lower exposure to acidic environment and food mixture, deficiency of the intrinsic factor in pepsin, combinations that are not appropriate in the alimentary bolus, exclusion of proximal areas of the small bowel, and also suboptimal consumption of nutrients. Something that could also happen, it's a vomit or diarrhea that are associated to the procedure the patient underwent. The preoperative prevalence of deficiencies usually is not as high as we think. For example, iron, 9 to 16%, folic acid, maybe 0 to 54%, and zinc, we have no data, thiamine, for example, 16 to 29%, B6, vitamin, 17 to 36%, B12 to 18%, but I have found that we have a higher deficiency with vitamin D. Up to 90% of patients submitted or undergoing this type of surgery. And this leads to the need to prepare patients better when they are going to be submitted to surgery. The purposes of this preparation are to decrease a little bit the body weight before the surgery, improve the adherence to the treatment in general. That means we have to start insisting in the fact that this is not going to be a magical solution. This is going to be a tool that is going to help us reach our target in terms of health, and also the motivation of the patient has to be taken into account. The decrease of the liver volume, improved ventilatory capacity, and correct deficiencies in case it is necessary. In the ABC Obesity Center, in the pre-op evaluation, we also make a full body DEXA or densitometry. We are interested to evaluate their body composition and evaluate evaluated with their patient has sarcopenia, osteopenia, or osteoporosis. And in case we have positive results, we have to request vitamin D levels. As such, well, there are no clinical guidelines to have a cutoff, a standardized cutoff for the population in general, but there are different trials that show some data in order to diagnose sarcopenia, whether a patient has sarcopenia or not. There is a trial in young patients, Mexican patients, adult patients, and healthy patients, and this is, for women and men, we have different cutoff points, and also for the appendicular index and the muscle skeletal point that we use to diagnose sarcopenia. And if our patient, after the lab studies, shows low levels, less than 20 nanograms per milliliter vitamin D, then we have to provide supplementation. And since these patients are obese, they require double supplementation. In the guidelines of the Journal of Clinical Endocrinal Metabolism, they suggest 6,000 to 10,000 international units per day. From 6 to 8 weeks, or until we get 30 nanograms per milliliter, and a maintenance therapy for obese patients from 3,000 to 6,000 international units a day. Also, within the pre-op preparation, we provide a preoperative course explaining the surgical technique, the importance of the multivitamin consumption all their lives, and also a new way of hydration. That means that the liquids have to be consumed 30 minutes before and 30 minutes late after the meal, and this is included also in the guidelines of the ASMBS. And also, we have to highlight the importance of the consumption of proteins and fiber after the surgery. And our objective is to raise awareness and to encourage patients to have a change of habits in the long term to avoid the nutritional deficiencies with a healthy weight loss. Within the pre-op preparation, we provide a pre-op diet with 1,195 calories in order to promote healthy weight loss and also a liver volume decrease. And this has been well tolerated by patients, and this is a very non-costly way to do it. We decided to have this management in a traditional or more conservative way because there are trials that have considered or where patients have taken food supplements to lose weight before the surgery compared with a standard diet where the calories are similar. And we have found that there are not significant differences taking a supplement or a standard diet. Both lose between, up to 6 kilos before the surgery, so it's really no point in making the patient spend in something that is going to have the same result as a standard diet. Also, I am showing you a review of some of pre-op diets where we can see that the lower calories, the lower number of calories in the pre-op diet, the higher decrease in the liver volume. So maybe 400 calories is very little, but maybe to assess a diet from 800 to 1,000 could be beneficial for a pre-op diet and to decrease the liver volume, which is going to make the surgical technique much easier. And then we submitted the patient to the surgery, and then we are going to restart orally. This is going to be 24 hours after the surgery, after the contrast, the intake of the contrast made by the surgeon. Then we're going to start the diet, liquid, a normal diet, until the point of a normal diet. Since this is a bariatric surgery, we have to take into consideration that they won't have any sugar to avoid the side effects. I'm going to tell you about the side effects in a moment. And to assess also the tolerance of this diet, and you know, to assess the tolerance to this diet and the GI symptoms. Okay, we will do this management, this traditional management, because we saw a trial. This is the only trial on bariatric surgery, and the hypothesis that the use of nutrition in the perioperative stage with the doses of carbohydrates from the pre followed by a peripheral NP may help patients with the gastric bypass to maintain the MLG compared with the standard group. And here the fast was 12 hours and then saline solution. And to the intervention group, they gave 12 hours and 2 hours before anesthesia, 800 milliliters and 400 milliliters of oral glucose, respectively, and they started peripheral parenteral nutrition up to an oral initial stage up to usually in the fourth day. And they found that there were not modifications in the excess of the weight lost or even in the muscle mass in the first and in the 12th month between the two groups. So it is not useful to submit a patient to parenteral nutrition if they are not going to have any results in the mass, in the muscle mass. Something that is also very important is the protein supplementation post-operation. We can use protein modules to avoid the fat-free mass and improve the scarring. We have to ensure a minimum consumption of 60 grams a day and also high. Hydration is very important until we assess the tolerance and to avoid any complications. And in terms of the long-term surveillance, the purposes are going to be to avoid deficiencies of vitamins and minerals, to avoid malnutrition, to supervise the weight loss that is through body fat, and also to avoid hypoalbuminemia, to change the habits, to avoid also the regain of their weight. I am going to talk about this later on. And also we have to supervise the supplementation with the minerals and vitamins that the patient requires, and also some posterior visits to the clinic. We suggest 1 week later, and this is based on the clinical guidelines, 1 week, 1 month, 3 months, 6, 9, and 12 months after the surgery, after the year, every 6 months, and after the second year, once a year. Now, what do we call weight regain? If the patient was submitted to bariatric surgery, it was because the patient wanted to lose weight. But there is a percentage from 20 to 25% of patients that regain weight. The reasons may be lack of exercise, not adherence to the diet, hormonal changes, some psychological factors, some anatomical factors, or sometimes this may be for the gut adaptation. Something that we want to avoid after the surgery is the dumping syndrome. This has an incidence of from 10 to 75% in patients. It is produced by a fast gastric emptying, and there are two types, early dumping between 10 to 30 minutes after the consumption of some food with lots of fat or sugar or alcohol, and late dumping between 1 to 3 hours after the consumption of food with these characteristics. And this is hypoglycemia, which is postprandial hypoglycemia with different symptoms in where patients feel really bad. This talks about the patient having a bad adherence to the nutritional plan, and this probably leads them to have some long-term or short-term nutritional guidelines. Here also we have a scale, a very good scale to measure the intensity and frequency if you want to use it. It has 15 questions. It's the dumping symptom rate scale. Well, the treatment to avoid the dumping syndrome is to avoid the consumption of simple sugars, fats, and alcohol, adjust the diet in 5 intakes, preferring the protein consumption, the consumption of vegetables, fruits, and integral cereals, maintain a hydration suggested after 1 bariatric surgery, this is 30 minutes before and 30 minutes after the consumption of food, and in case of not showing an improvement in the symptoms with all these strategies, then we have to study the reasons of these hypoglycemias of these patients. Now we are going to talk a little bit about the prevention of deficiencies also during pregnancy. When a woman is admitted to bariatric surgery, well, it is recommendable to get pregnant between 12 to 24 months after the surgery. This has not really been very well established, but it is a recommendation. Non-oral ways of preventing pregnancy and a recommended gain of 7 kilograms if they have a BMI of 26.1 to 29 and 11 to 16 kilograms if they have a BMI of 19 to 26 kilograms with a calorie contribution in both groups from 1,000 to 1,200 kilocalories a day. We have to identify if the symptoms are pregnancy symptoms or dumping syndrome symptoms. There are some risks associated to pregnancy and bariatric surgery. It could be preterm pregnancy, low weight at the moment of birth, and restriction of the fetal growth. And the biochemical tests that must be performed to these patients include iron, folic acid, B12, vitamin, calcium, and the monitoring of liposoluble vitamins. We have that we know that the pregnant women are a group that are at risk of deficiency because they have a low consumption of nutrients or they have food intolerance, nausea, and vomit. This also contributes to the deficiency. And the supplementation that we suggest, well, it's the following: calcium citrate, vitamin D, iron, B12, vitamin B12, folic acid, and zinc. And well, in terms of general patients, the long-term supervision, it's been important. We have seen that the highest deficiency we have is iron from 20 to 55% in the patients admitted to a gastric bypass. In calcium, 25.9%, folic acid, 65%, and zinc, up to 70% in patients with biliopancreatic shunt. B1, we don't have any data because basically this study is performed after the surgery. Vitamin C, B6 and B12, we have 14 and 12 to 33% respectively in patients with bypass without supplementation. And well, talking about vitamin A, we have some risk, 11%, with biliopancreatic shunt, deficiency of vitamin D. We have some preoperative screening, but we don't have any data post-operation. Vitamin E and vitamin K, it's difficult to know. And well, as nutriologists, we have some nutritional goals or recommendations that we have to convey to the patients. For example, the consumption of proteins, minimum 60 grams a day, optimum between 70 to 90 grams a day, or 1.5 grams protein per kilograms of ideal weight. And we have to insist to avoid simple sugars, include fruits and vegetables within their diet, integral cereals, and also we have to supervise the tolerance, especially in the first months post-operation. In terms of water, remember, some recommendations are not to consume water with meals, drink slowly, avoid some beverages like caffeine, caloric or alcoholic beverages, and minimum 1.5 liters of water. This is what we suggest for a correct hydration. Now, in terms of supplementation, well, in the last talks, you listened some information about this. We suggest for calcium, vitamin D, multivitaminic products or multivitamin products, prenatal vitamins that may supplement this type of patients because they have a good iron and folic acid amount. And well, some patients, as you know, cannot swallow. And then we have several presentations. We have chewable tablets. We have IM or intramuscular sublingual. And in the United States, last year, they launched liquid iron. So if you order even by Amazon, it could also work. And monitoring, biochemical monitoring is also very important. As you can see here, this is according to the ASMBS guidelines. And as a conclusion, I can tell you that the evaluation pre and post-operation is really important to prevent and treat these patients. We have to provide the appropriate consumption of proteins from the trans and perioperative stages and post-operative stages. The multidisciplinary follow-up is very important, not only the nutritional assessment, but also the medical assessment and the psychological assessment. And if we have a physician, a specialist in sports, they can help us to prevent sarcopenia or to improve it if the patient already presents this. They have to consume the suitable doses of multivitamin products, and nutritional education is very important since the preoperative stage, because sometimes they have a magical idea and they believe that they are going to lose weight magically. And no, that's not true. There is a risk to regain weight, and this risk is really considerable. And thanks a lot. Well, we